Just sing that chorus together one more time. Let's sing, "Come and Behold."
Come and behold Him, the one and the only. joined us during the week. We are here on, what are we here on? What day is this, everybody? Mother's Day. Actually, the church would call it Mothering Sunday. And it comes from the 16th century, where really many people were thinking at that point in time, one Sunday in the year where people could go back to what was called their mother church. And because they did that, they also got to see their parents, they got to see their mothers, especially those who were in domestic service. It's also another Sunday. It's the fourth Sunday in Lent. And we call it fourth Sunday in Lent, but in many churches across the world, it's called by a Latin name. I wonder, can we have that up, Josh? Next one. Later Sunday, and that means rejoice. And so it seems to be an appropriate Sunday morning to think about what it means to have joy in our lives, what it means to rejoice. And of course, as part of our service this morning, we're going to rejoice in all our ladies who are here and all the ladies who are part of our lives, part of our families, part of our wider family circle, our friendship groups. And so you are all welcome as we join together this morning. Can I just give you a few announcements just to remember? Sometimes we have to hear them as well as see them. So tonight we have what's called a Mission in Ireland rally, which is for the Presbytery of Ards. It's going to be hosted by Hamilton Road, and it's 6:30 p.m. tonight. And I want to encourage you, if you can, to come along to that. Next Sunday morning, we're looking forward to our PW service, and our guest speaker is Eleanor Drysdale. She's a very experienced and wonderful deaconess from Ballymena. She's coming to join us. After the service, there will be lunch as usual, and so this morning, as you go out to the hub for your refreshments, the ladies of PW will be there to encourage you to come to lunch next Sunday morning. And so please, if you can, that would be great to be able to do that and to join with them next Sunday morning. And I know, as always, we'll get a delightful lunch. We want to remind everybody, ladies, the PW meet this Tuesday evening, and this is going to be a really, I think, a lovely evening together. The theme for PW in the year has been Deeper Together. And so the theme for this Tuesday is Deeper Together Across the Generations. And I know that we're going to have some young people with us, and those a bit more experienced who are going to share a little bit about their faith journey. So everybody is welcome, ladies, to our meeting on Tuesday evening. We hope you'll come. The other thing that's out there is at last the flyer, the leaflet about our congregational weekend. As David said that last week, there's so many options for us, and so we wanted to get it down on paper so that you could take it away and fill it in. And so there are copies in the foyer or the porch and in the hub this morning, so please take one away. And we do hope that you'll plan to come with us to Ganaway from the 9th to the 11th of June. Now, can we take a moment just to be still? Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can freely come to worship you this morning. But we're here to encourage one another. We're here to hear from you, Lord Jesus, that you would speak to us, that you would communicate your love as well as the challenge that you have for us today. We thank you that we come on this day and you call us to rejoice. And you call us to do that every day, Lord. So we come to rejoice in you and your love for us. We come to rejoice in our fellowship together. We come to rejoice in the gift of motherhood. We come, our Heavenly Father, to rejoice in your goodness, your love, and your mercy. And so would you come and inhabit the praises of your people here? For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand, sing 10,000 Reasons and then Amazing Love.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. To bless the Lord, O my soul. Spirit is within me. that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love,
thank you that you're here with us this morning. Father, we give you thanks that you sent your Son to die, and we celebrate that in a couple of weeks, Lord. But Father, as we think about joy this morning, let it be our joy, our real deep joy that we know you. Let that sink in, that we know the Creator of the universe, the hands that flung the stars into space. We know you. You know us. And we can call you our friend. We give you thanks for that. Amen.
Now, has anybody got a birthday to celebrate this morning? Oh, we have. Yes. Anybody here? Ariana's here. Yep. We want to say a huge happy birthday to some of our senior members, including Essie, who is our, we believe, our most senior member, who was 102 on Friday. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? You weren't 102, Ariana, were you? How old were you?
Six.
Six. And when were you six? Was it this past week? Yes. And did you have a party? What did you do? Anything exciting?
Had birthday cake.
You had birthday cake? And what was it?
Princess.
A princess, of course. It would be a princess. And did you eat it all? Did other people help you eat it all? And did you get nice gifts? Well, that's wonderful. Can we pray for you? Would that be okay? And there's no one, yeah, Ariana's our only, yep. You're our youngest for birthday week this week. All our folks are, some of them are over. We'll not say. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your gift of life to us, and for your gift of love, and for your gift of family. And we thank you especially this morning for Ariana. We thank you that she has enjoyed her sixth birthday with birthday cake and with lovely gifts and with her family. But we thank you that she's also part of our church family, Lord. And we pray that you would bless her in all that she does. We pray that she will know you're with her when she goes to school, or when she's spending time at home, or when she's with her friends, or when she's here in church, Lord. We thank you that you love her, and we do, and we pray your blessing on her in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. Would you like to have a wee dig in? Now, I'm going to put this down a wee minute here. While Ariana's having a wee look, I have a video for you. I asked Caroline, who, if she would interview some of the young people that were here last Sunday night, and also then some of the GB girls on Wednesday evening about their mums. So I'm going to apologise now. I haven't seen it. My thanks to Gary and Caroline for putting it all together. I gave Caroline 4 questions to ask the children and young people. So are we good to go, Josh? Great.
She's really loving and she gives us lots of hugs.
My favourite thing about her is that she takes me to training every day of the week and just is always there to help.
Kind she is, and how loving she is to everyone around her.
The favourite thing about my mum, there's lots and lots of things that are favourite about my mum, but one thing is that she puts everybody else before her, before herself.
My favourite thing about my mum is she makes these sewing things, and they're like wee pictures of people doing things or like items. I find them really cool and I really like them.
My mum is a very proud mum and she loves her family and she loves her home.
My mummy lets me have movie nights.
Because she's the most loveliest mummy in the world.
Probably Hosanna's dancing, because she always, like, the thing I find funny as well, me and my mum, is that, like, she never has, like, really any routine. She always just goes, like, free-for-all. It's quite good.
Oh, I think probably the cat running around the house and just jumping all over the place, and he's got wee walls he smacks around the place. It makes her laugh.
Mum always laughs at me because I'm so accident prone and stuff, and when I tell her I hurt myself again, she just bursts out with laughter.
Silly things make my mum laugh, generally me being silly, just goofing around really and laughing and joking and carrying on.
My mum laughs at me for doing really random funny things that don't even make sense, and laughs at quite a few random things that aren't even funny.
Me, just being me at times.
Doing sleepy kisses.
When I tell her jokes.
Tough one, probably flare nostrils. Whenever she like laughs, she just goes against.
The funniest thing she does is probably just be herself, you know, just, I mean, makes me laugh all the time, just jokes are stupid, so stupid they're funny, but yeah.
When she sings along to her favourite songs in the kitchen while she's cooking.
Funniest thing my mum does is just bursting into song when you're sort of least expecting it, kind of like in a musical.
She walks into rooms sometimes and asks me what she's looking for. Forgetful, can't remember it, it's really funny.
The funniest thing about my mum is that she can't say the word penguin. She says, penguin!
She tickles me!
I love my mum because she's always there for me.
I love my mum because she's a brilliant cook and she provides for us every night.
I love my mum because she's always there for me, and anytime I need to talk, she just talks to me and she provides for me everything, and she's just the best.
Lots of reasons, like one being that she always knows what I'm thinking and what I'm feeling and just let me have them say it.
What I love my mum? I love my mum, there's too many things to say about her. That are amazing, but I love her because through all things in our lives, she's been there as a constant, and she's there through thick and thin, supporting you, and she's just unmovable and just amazing.
I love my mum because she's really helpful to me and my sisters and dad. She helps us with homework, she cooks our dinners and lunches, and she's just really helpful and kind.
I love my mum because she loves me for the person that I am, and she's very kind and loving.
Because she lets me have sausage and chips.
Because we get to do fun things together.
My mum can't say the word penguin. She says penguin. And I think I just did it there, did I? I meant penguin.
Thank you so much to all those folks. That's brilliant, brilliant. Boys and girls, do you want to come down? I've got gifts for all the ladies this morning. So you will have to come down to help me. There's a few. Thank you. So, you know, it wouldn't be Mother's Day or Father's Day without a wee bit of something corny. And obviously, I haven't been able to bake this year. For Father's Day, you never know. I'm not promising, but you never know. I might be able to do that. But so trying to think today what we could give to all the ladies over the age of 18 in the congregation. So there's a little card that says, Happy Mother's Day. Thanks for your commitment, involvement, encouragement, and there's a bag of mints. So, that's the best I could do. So, boys and girls, what I would like you to do first is you take, if your mum or your granny or your auntie is here, and I know some of you share a mum, you could take one to them and then come back, and I need you to help me give them to all the ladies upstairs and downstairs. Maybe the older ones could go upstairs for me to all the ladies, if you wouldn't mind. Right, okay, dig in, take one. Here's the other one. Oh, here's another one. Over here. And do it as quickly without falling as possible. And then come back and help. There we go. You're going to give it to Mummy? You give it to Mummy.
Where's she? My mum's upstairs.
You take it to her.
Do you want to get one and give it to Rebecca?
Okay. And then go and give it to all the other ladies all around. Thank you, Isabella. Thank you. Right, guys, you go and give it to the ladies downstairs. Yeah, take a couple, Harry, and give it wherever Mum is. Right? Thanks, Danny. Okay. Got more here. Thank you. You've given Jenny, and you give it to someone else. Good boy. Right, here we are. More here. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, there's one's fallen. Hang on. Right. Give a couple, maybe, Zach, wherever you go. Now, you take some to some of the ladies. Good boy. Now, let's look. Hands up, ladies, if you don't have one yet. So we need to do this side here. Okay, this side up there. Up. Yeah. There we go. There we go. Good job. Right. Rosie. Hands up, ladies. Over there, Rosie. Oh, here you go. Right, boys. There's maybe down the middle there. Down the middle. Down the middle aisle. Down the middle aisle. You all got ladies? Yes. Keep your hands up if you need a bag, ladies. How are we doing upstairs? Come on over. Okay, hang on a wee minute. We'll not need maybe any more, Rosie, I don't think. And if you want to bring the others that are spare back. Just a wee minute, Jen. Now, has every lady got one? Yep. Thank you so much for your for your... thank you very much. That's great. Take your time, Hosanna. Watch, Rebecca. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Anna. Thank you. That's very kind. Now, are we all right? James, you're okay? They're mints. Isaac, mints. They're glass mints. What are they? I'm going to put this down here just now. Yes, go and give it to Mum. Quick, James. You all right? You go to Mama, Isabella. So we're going to sing a children's song now. I don't know. Peace Like a River. Anybody know the Actions? Come on out, Rosie. All of you who know the Actions, come on out. Yeah. We're counting on you. Stand up here, do the Actions, and we'll all join in. Okay? Good girls. Just to say, you're after the song, the children are going out to Big Tree House. But as I promised last week and in the email, we have set up in the McKinstry Wallace Hall two photo booths for you to go, boys and girls, take Mum, or you can take Dad too, or whoever's with you, and get family photos taken. And I've got signs like these there that you can... My mum is a superhero. There are different signs that you guys can use in your photo. David's going to direct you all there and just line up and take your time. What we'd ask is that you take the photo. The photos will be taken with your phone, and then we'd love you to send it to us so that we can put something on our new website and our social media platform. So we hope that you'll take your time and do that this morning after church. Now, over to you, Mark. Thanks.
Right, guys, you ready?
Yes.
Sure? This is going to be a bit mad. Ready, Tom? Ready? I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got love like an ocean in my soul.
Done, thank you guys. Have a great morning. We'll see you at the photo booths after church. To invite the ladies who are going to join with me in reading a piece this morning. This piece has been written was written by an American lady. And after being at church on one Mother's Day, she wrote to her pastor and asked him to think about the fact that not everybody in church that morning would have been full of the joys of spring. Not everybody, every lady who was there would have been a mother. And for many folks, for many ladies, this day is a difficult day. And so she wrote this piece, and we want to share it with you this morning. It's called The Wide Spectrum of Mothering.
To those who gave birth this year to their first child, we celebrate with you.
To those who lost a child this year, we mourn with you.
To those who are in the trenches with little ones every day and wear the badge of food stains, we appreciate you.
To those who experience loss through miscarriage, failed adoptions, or running away, we mourn with you.
To those who walk the hard path of infertility, fraught with pokes, prods, tears, and disappointment, we walk with you. Forgive us when we say foolish things. We don't mean to make this harder than it is.
To those who are foster mums, mentor mums, and spiritual mums, we need you.
To those who have warm and close relationships with your children, we celebrate you.
To those who have disappointment, heartache, and distance with your children, we sit with you.
To those who lost their mothers this year, we grieve with you.
To those who experienced abuse at the hands of their own mother, we acknowledge your experience.
To those who lived through driving tests, medical tests, and the overall testing of motherhood, we are better for having you in our midst.
To those who have aborted children, we remember them and you on this day.
To those who are single and long to be married and mothering your own children, we mourn that life has not turned out the way you longed for it to be.
To those who step parent, we walk with you on these complex paths.
To those who envisioned lavishing love on grandchildren, yet that dream is not to be, we grieve with you.
To those who will have emptier nests in the upcoming year, we grieve and rejoice with you.
To those who place children up for adoption, we commend you for your selflessness and remember how you hold that child in your heart.
And to those who are pregnant with new life, both expected and surprising, we anticipate with you.
This Mother's Day, we walk with you all. Mothering is not for the faint of heart, and we have real warriors in our midst. We celebrate you, we remember you, we thank you. And maybe we'll just take a moment before Joy comes to read the scriptures, just to reflect and to be still and to pray. God, you are our Father, but you tell us too in your word that you care for us like a mother. And you have created us in your image, male and female, you have created us. But on this day, Lord, we thank you for all that you are and have done in and through those who mother in every different way. Not just biological mums, spiritual mums, mums who mentor, women and families who have that role, We bless you, Lord. And we pray that for any of us here this morning, that we would know your presence and your peace as we journey through those complex relationships that we have and as we celebrate on this Mother's Day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our reading this morning is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen.
Joy. I wonder how many of you have heard of a woman called Marie Kondo. Hands up if you've heard of Marie Kondo. No? No? Some of you? No? Well, Marie Kondo is a Japanese lady, and she has become incredibly famous for helping people to basically tidy up their homes. She's what is called an organizing consultant. And let me tell you, I would need her in our house at this moment in time. She helps people declutter. She has written 4 books on organizing. She's sold millions of copies on right across the world. And she's also big on Netflix. So you can have a wee look to see if you can find her. Her method is called the KonMari method. You start, apparently, with all your belongings. Think about them all. You start with your clothes. And what she does is she gets everybody, whoever she's going to help, to bring their clothes, and they go on a bed. And they, if you've never seen it, you can imagine just the pile of clothes that come in someone's house. Then you go to your books or your papers or some of the other miscellaneous things that you have in your house. Now, here's why it's relevant for us today. What she says you have to do is you pick up every item. So you pick up this dress, ladies, or that jacket, gentlemen, and go, does it spark joy in me? That's what she asks you to think about. And if it doesn't spark joy, what you're to do is to leave it down and to give it away, either to charity or, if it's not good, to bin it. And so she helps people to only have in their house things that spark joy. If only it were that simple, isn't it? Joy in our lives is something that I think for many of us has been missing in these past few years, hasn't it? The call, Paul's call, the Bible's call to rejoice, and I say it again, he says, to rejoice, a call to joy-filled living hasn't been particularly heard, has it? You know, we have a misconception about it, though, and that's why it's important to talk about it. We misunderstand what joy actually is. If we equate joy with happiness and expect to always have an emotional high, then we will be always disappointed. That's the wrong definition of joy. There is a difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is an outward expression, and it depends on happenings. That's where the word comes from. Happiness comes and goes with the circumstances of our lives. Our happiness level goes up and down, often because of what we're going through. It is an old word, happiness, that means chance. And that helps us to understand that up and down nature of it. Whereas joy is an inner state of our heart. It's meant to be a constant in our lives as Christian people. And joy, we are told throughout Scripture, will endure hardship, it will endure trials, it has meaning and it has purpose. Apparently, a number of researchers have found out right across the world, especially in the Western civilization, the States and Europe, the United Kingdom, that two-thirds of us would say we're not happy. Now, in these last few years, we can understand why. COVID has had such an effect on us. I think many of us are still experiencing a kind of low-level depression because of it. There are some of us who still don't feel that they can come back out to church or really to do very much that involves a lot of people. We're concerned. But what Paul is saying to us today in this scripture is a call to joy. Some things that famous people have said about joy, we've got a few quotes and Josh will put them up. The first is from Oliver Wendell Holmes. It's really interesting. I might have entered the ministry if certain clergymen I knew had not looked and acted so much like undertakers. The next one is Robert Louis Stevenson. Wonder of wonders, I have been to church today and I'm not depressed. C.S. Lewis, joy is the serious business of heaven. And then we have one by a man called Billy Sunday. Billy Sunday was a baseball player in the United States who came to know the Lord Jesus and became an evangelist. And he says this, if you have no joy, there's a serious leak in your Christianity somewhere. And then, of course, we know what from the book of Nehemiah, we are told that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And then in Philippians 4, that passage that Joy read for us this morning, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. So why does it not seem to be so evident in the Church of Jesus Christ? In any generations. And Christians who we are called to be transformed, who know what Jesus did for us on the cross and know that it was sufficient and know that if we receive it, gives us life in all its fullness. Life in abundance is another translation of that word. Life everlasting. That the Holy Spirit is the one who is in us to help us bear fruit because joy is a fruit of the Spirit. We have gone through such a challenging season, haven't we? And not only COVID, but each of us in our own particular family life or individual lives, we could say, oh, but Marcia, you don't know what I've been through. It's been hard, it's been difficult, whether it's been bereavement or illness or a difficult relationship, whatever it is, it's really hard to be joyful all the time. Well, it's good to be at the other side of COVID, but what we do know is the reality of life is that things happen to us. Difficult, challenging things happen to us. The circumstances we find ourselves in as individuals and families, and no matter what is happening around us, what Paul says is choose and joy. Philippians has been called the epistle of joy. We find the Apostle Paul not in a lovely situation that you might imagine because of all this talk about rejoicing and joy, but we find him in prison. He's in a Roman jail. It's 62 AD. He'd been in Jerusalem. He'd been falsely accused, then arrested. He'd been taken to Caesarea. He had had trials over the last 2 years. Nothing was happening, and so he decided to appeal to Caesar as a Roman citizen. And so they decided to take him to Rome. They decided to take him to Rome by a boat, which is, if you remember your history of Paul, it was shipwrecked. And so they sent another boat, and they got him to Rome. He'd been beaten, he'd been shipwrecked, he'd been falsely accused. Every manner of thing that you could imagine had happened to him. Things that we will never potentially ever go through because of our faith. You wouldn't imagine that he would be saying, folks, you need to have joy in your life, would you? And more than that, he doesn't know what's going to happen to him. Is he going to be released or is he going to be beheaded? And so in that situation, and knowing the people that he was writing to in the church in Philippi and all that was going on with them, he says, guys, it's time. Rejoice in the Lord. I'm going to say it again. And he does say it again and again through this book. And the joy of the Lord is the focus of the book. Paul is so anchored, so trusting in the Lord Jesus that he can be nothing but joyful, no matter the circumstances that he was in. And he's chained to guards, so he doesn't even have his own independence. He is literally chained to Roman guards most of the time. You know all that we and I have been through these last few months. You know some of the things that I experienced, that you have experienced, that cause us to be robbed of joy at times. Difficulties, illness, chronic pain, those sorts of things. I want to ask us all today, and I include myself in this, how are we doing with our joy levels? How are we doing? Are your circumstances allowing you to be down, are not giving you the opportunity to experience joy that Paul's talking about? Are there people around you and I who are critical, who are just hard work, who speak negative words to us on a constant basis, who gossip about us? How can we have joy when all that's going on around us? You know, God intended us to have loving, fruitful relationships, and that these relationships that he has given to us should cause and spark joy in our lives. And so the other side of it is when there's conflict in relationships, that can sap our joy, can't it? Paul knew what that was about. He was writing to this church where two women, some verses that were spoken of before the piece that the passage that Joy read, Eudias and Syntyche. But when things go wrong there, the joy is taken away. And so what Paul is saying is, don't think of those things. Don't think of material things. They'll never bring you the joy that God wants for us. But instead, it's in the Lord. It's in the Lord. And he says, understand that it's not an automatic response, joy. We can't just be joyful. But what he has discovered, Paul the Apostle, is that it's a learned experience. We're called to choose it, to make joy our focus and our intent. In verse 11 that Joy read, we heard those words of Paul saying, I have learned to be content in all circumstances. Remember King David, before he was king, being pursued by Saul? 1 Samuel 30 says this, then David encouraged himself in the Lord. And that's what Paul is saying to us. Encourage yourself. It's not about someone else creating your joy. It's not about what they do or what they say to you. It's us, ourselves, intentionally going after joy. And when we rejoice in the Lord, our joy is a byproduct of the relationship that we have with God. So here's a few things I want you to remember to help us to grow in that relationship. And so grow in our joy. We have the Word of God. We have the Scriptures. In those Scriptures, we read about who He is and who we are. He is sovereign, yes? We believe it? Do we? Yes. We're children of the Most High God? Yes. All things work together for good for those who love him? Yes. There are times when we have to stand on the truth of God's word, because other things around us will go crumbling. And what about what Paul says in another scripture in Romans 4, verse 18? He says this, he's talking about Abraham. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed and so became the father of many nations. If you're thinking today it's not as easy, Marisina, just to choose joy, well, actually, I'm telling you it is. Because there are so many people down through the scriptures who made choices that changed their lives, heart, mind, body. Abraham was one of them. He believed as a man who had no children, who met with God, and God told him, as Mark shared earlier, that he was going to lead and the nation would become as prolific as all the stars in the sky. This man who, with his wife, they hadn't been able to have a child. And so Abraham, it said, believed what God was saying, and it became, and he became the father of many nations. So I'm asking you today, what are you believing? What are you believing? Are you believing in God's word? That he is sovereign, that you are a child of God, that all things work together for good? Are you believing on the foundation of scripture? Or are you believing what the world tells you? That you'll only be happy if you get a nice house, drive a nice car, get well paid. One of the things that's happening to our younger generation is that they are allowing social media to dictate to them how they should live and what they should go after. If those of you haven't been on Instagram, you'll see all these beautiful homes. And people are wanting those beautiful homes, but they're not going to potentially be able to have them because they don't have the level of income that those people have. Or you see all these gorgeous, beautiful bodies and faces. And they try and tell us that if we buy this product or that product, then we'll be happy because we'll look like they look. It is a nonsense. On Tuesday night, we were, some of us, along with a number of other folks around the denomination and church house, considering how we can be pastoral, how we can be loving, how we can be welcoming to those who are struggling with same-sex attraction. And those people who were leading us up the front, they were talking about the culture and context in which we are living in. And for many people there, it was news to them. And so one of the things I want us to do after Easter is we're going to be looking on Sunday evenings at some of those important worldviews that are out there, because we, especially those of us who are parents and grandparents or have our organizational leaders in BB and GB, we need to understand this world that the younger generations are living in. And what we are told is that social media is catechizing the young. That old word that all of us know because we learned our catechisms. In other words, the social media is teaching our children and our young people how to be and what to think and what to do with their lives. That will always steal joy from them. Abraham, in hope, believed, and so became. What if you and I believed the truth of what God's word tells us about who we are, each unique? And comparison is another joy stealer. When we compare ourselves to other people, Mark Twain said that. He said, comparison is the thief of joy. Because we think, well, we would like what they have. Look what they've got. Look what they do. And instead, why don't we believe that God has a call on my life and your life that is unique and is not like this, the person next to you? What if you We're starting to believe that you were created by the Most High God, and he tells you you're wonderfully, you're fearfully, you're beautifully made. What if we believed that there was no one like us because God has created us in that way? We don't need to be like anyone else. And if we want to do that, if that's what we're looking at and thinking, oh, I wish, joy will quickly go. What are we believing so that we can become something different? People who carry joy, people who spark joy in other people, whether it's our families or our friends or our work colleagues. And I want to leave you with this thought from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. We've got to remember that joy is not dependent on our circumstances. Joy is not happiness. Instead, joy is our focus. It's our intent. It's what we want to choose and how we want to choose to live. And if we do that, we're following very clearly the Lord Jesus. The author of Hebrews tells us this, that if we fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, in other translations, it's author as well, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He believed that the cross and what he was going to do on the cross would bring joy. And so he endured it. There are times when we have to think of the bigger picture, especially when we're going through the difficult days. If we are called as we are to follow Jesus, if we're called as we are to model Jesus, to reflect Jesus, to be more like Jesus, that's the Christian life. I wonder what you're believing. Are you like the Lord Jesus, who knew that no matter the pain that he was about to go through, that there was a purpose for that pain? And that purpose is here today. 2,000 years later, people who love him, who follow him, who want to be like him. The thing that sparks joy in us is him. We can't have it on our own. We're sinful human beings. We're frail human beings. But if we say yes to Jesus Christ, if we say yes, come Lord Jesus, forgive me my sin, be present in my life, the Holy Spirit comes in and he leads us to a place, a continual place of joy, no matter the circumstances. I hope that you believe that he can do that in you and he can do that in me. And then we will become carriers of joy and spark joy in other people and in other situations. I pray that we do that. Let's pray. Just want you to take a moment as the guys are getting ready to lead us in the wonderful old hymn, Blessed Assurance, to ask yourself, what am I believing about the life that I'm living? And if we're believing, maybe some of us are believing we're not unique, we're useless, we don't have what other people have, we're not as clever, we're not as pretty, we're not as good looking, we don't have what the money that other people have, then I ask and I encourage you to ask God by his Spirit to come and to remove that lie that we have to be like other people. And Lord, we ask that you spark joy in us today by your Spirit. That you would be a constant presence in our lives. And that because of that, Lord Jesus, we would rejoice in everything you've given to us. All that you have done for us. All the promises of yes and amen. And help us to receive those promises, Lord, to stand on them and your word, and to choose joy today, to choose to rejoice, to believe, and then to become your joy carriers. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Just before we sing this song, I felt led, just as Maracena was speaking there, to share with you the story behind this song, Blessed Assurance. You may know it, but if you don't, then hopefully this will bless you. It's talking into the whole thing about joy, but it's also talking about mothers and the importance of mothers and grandmothers. So Frances Jane Crosby was born in 1820, so over 200 years ago. As a baby, she had an eye infection, which a dodgy doctor treated by placing a hot poultice on her eyes, which caused scarring. That infection cleared up, but the scars formed in her eyes and blinded her for life. A few months later, she lost her dad. He died at the age of, the mum was 21, I'm not sure what age the dad was. But Mercy Crosby, Fanny's mum, had to work. She hired herself out as a maid, and it was the grandmother that took care of Fanny. She took care of the education of her little granddaughter and became the girl's eyes, vividly describing the physical world. Her careful teaching helped develop Fanny's descriptive abilities. She also nurtured Fanny's spirit. She read and carefully explained the Bible to her, and she always emphasized the importance of prayer. When Fanny became depressed because she couldn't learn as other children did, so she was comparing as well, her granny taught her to pray to God for knowledge. In 1834, Fanny learned of the New York Institute for the Blind and knew this was the answer to her prayers for an education. She went to school when she was 12 and went on to teach there for 23 years. Became something of a celebrity, writing poems for almost every conceivable occasion. She got married to a musician who was considered one of the finest organists in the New York area. But one evening, Fanny's friend and composer, Phoebe Knapp, was visiting and played a tune on the piano. Asking Fanny, what did it sound like to her? Fanny responded, "Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine." She chose joy. Despite being blind, she chose joy. And that was through the influence of her mother's mother. So let that be an encouragement for the grannies out there as well as the mums. But also choose joy. We're going to play this, just the verse 3 for you. It's a slightly different rhythm. It's the same tune. But it's slowed down slightly just to let you reflect on the words that blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's yours. He's ours. What greater thing could there be to give us joy than knowing that?
Thank you.
So join with us. Let's stand and sing. Just watch for the wee pause. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. Perfect my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
To finish on today. We're called to carry joy. We're called to joy. May we encourage one another to be that person as we share the words of the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. I encourage you to go out, find your children. Oh, yes, folks, sorry. Just as you're going, as you know, folks pray before the service, and they ask God.